Welcome to Insight. Today we are chatting with Dorothy Stoneman, founder and CEO of YouthBuild USA. In YouthBuild programs, low-income youth ages 16 to 24 work full-time for 6 months to 2 years toward their GEDs or high school diplomas while learning job skills by building affordable housing. Emphasis is placed on leadership development, community service, and the creation of a positive mini-community of adults and youth dedicated to each other's success. Dorothy has generously agreed to share some of her experience with us. I'd like to thank you, Dorothy, for joining us today.
Glad to be here.
So creating these mini communities is such a fascinating approach to helping youth evolve toward their own success. Talk about the genesis of YouthBuild. When you founded it in 1990, it was a real breakthrough as a model.
1990 was the beginning of YouthBuild USA Incorporated, which is the national nonprofit support center for these local programs. Mm-hmm. The original program I started in 1978 in East Harlem, and it took 10 years before we began to scale it up. It was a natural, logical response to what teenagers were showing and telling me that they needed. They needed to belong to something where they felt safe, where they felt respected, where they felt like it could make a difference. They had very vivid feelings about what needed to be changed in their communities, and they loved the opportunity to build affordable housing. They also had very specific needs around education and job training and preparing for college, preparing for any kind of real employment. And so we integrated their vision for how they'd like to fix up their community, because there were at that time 600 abandoned buildings in East Harlem.
Right.
And what they actually needed for their own success.
And what you're saying is that the programs were actually designed by the youth themselves.
Right, right. My sense, and I had been in Harlem since 1964. I had joined the civil rights movement, I had been a school teacher, and I had run a parent-controlled, community-based school in East Harlem. But what was happening to the teenagers was so terrible. I had a vision that young people could be a very powerful force for change, that we needed to build a youth movement. It was coming out of the 60s, out of the civil rights movement, but there are all of these young people who are still completely out of it. So I began to ask groups of young people, what would you do to improve your community if I could get the resources and the adult support to back you up in what you wanted to change? And so, of course, they had a million ideas, and their ideas were all very tuned into their reality. One thing was they wanted to rebuild all these abandoned buildings. Another was that they wanted to create a leadership school. They wanted to fix all the parks, turn them into beautiful gardens. They wanted to end crime by having youth patrols in the public housing projects. They wanted to have a home away from home for young mothers who had no place to live with their children. So we did all of those things, and we did that for about 10 years. And all of them were very successful. But when it became time to replicate this program nationally or first citywide, mm-hmm. We decided to go with the building of affordable housing because it was so visible, it was so tangible, and because it simultaneously addressed so many important issues in the community, including education, job training, crime prevention, affordable housing, and even now that we build green, it's also addressing some of the environmental concerns. And of course, overall, the leadership development piece is key to any low-income community.
So in 78, you create these programs in collaboration with those you're serving in Harlem. Continue talking about how you came to 1990, where you found YouthBuild USA, the national organization.
Once it was established in East Harlem, mm-hmm. The young people began to say, and I was completely behind them, let's spread this. Other young people should have the same opportunity. So we organized a citywide coalition mm-hmm. called, at that time we called it the Coalition for $10 Million. And we went to the city government in a group, and we spoke out at public hearings, and we brought hundreds of young people to City Hall while they were developing their budgets and called for more opportunities for young people to rebuild their communities. And we succeeded.
So this is the nefarious community organizing model.
Yes.
The community organizing? Nefarious. The, 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 the whole idea of people getting together and saying, we want to do something, and the community, expressed through government and funding and so on and so forth, ought to support this. So
right.
there was an advocacy piece, and then what happened?
Well, and in addition to an advocacy piece, I mean, it's community organizing as such has at its heart really engaging people in the political and the democratic process in a way that they had not felt they knew how to do, right? So low-income young people are typically not going to City Hall, speaking out at public hearings, and meeting with their elected officials because they feel like there's such a huge gulf between them and that world, and they're not paying attention to it. So it's part of the leadership development to say, you know, your voice can be heard, here's how to do it,
right.
You know, and so together we do that. We continue to do that at the state and national level. So, you know, when you succeed, because suddenly there's young people rising up to be heard in a respectful way with a lot to say. So then we replicated the program in New York City, and then people began to come from around the country and say, how did you do this? We want to do the same thing in our community. So around 1988, we formed a national coalition.
And how did people who were on the more the commercial side, people who were investing in property, builders, and other business interests and so on, how did they respond to this idea of having these investments take place within certain areas?
There's public funding for mm-hmm. the building of affordable housing. There
right.
was state funding at that time, mm-hmm. the Homeless Housing Assistance Program. There's federal funding. So the government invests in affordable housing for low-income people. And then you use contractors to actually build the housing, and
so
we would have to negotiate with those contractors.
So they're private contractors who are involved. There are businesses that are providing these services. There are local merchants who see their neighborhoods improving, which improves their situation.
Mm-hmm.
It really becomes a type of a program that can be supported by everybody.
Right.
Did you ever encounter real strong opposition to any of the work that you were doing?
In fact, no. There's never been opposition from anyone in any consistent way because it's so obviously a good thing. You suddenly have young people who are earning a living, getting their high school diploma, going to college, who were headed in the opposite direction before that, and then you have something tangible of value to the community. And, you know, our advocacy approach is also not an oppositional approach.
Right.
We really, in the same way we treat every young person as having value and intelligence, we treat every policymaker as somebody who can be persuaded about the truth and the reality of what the young people are facing if we can just get them to listen and pay attention.
So it's not a political issue. It's really about how do you create an effective approach to reducing urban blight, to giving these youth a way to release their energy in very positive ways, to helping communities strengthen themselves.
Right. However, it becomes political because there isn't the political will to invest in approaches like this at the scale that they're actually needed to really change the situation. So here you have a situation where YouthBuild has expanded over since 1992.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there was a moment with the help of certain political leaders who said to themselves what you just said, hey, this is good for everybody, we're going to spread it, like Senator John Kerry.
Right.
Congressman Major Owens took the lead back in 1992, and they got a bill passed. So YouthBuild started in East Harlem, became a federal program.
Right.
It became authorized in public law, equivalent to Peace Corps, Head Start, et cetera. And although it was the only one that had started from the grassroots, really.
Mm-hmm.
And then each year, the government has to make an appropriation to continue or to expand this federal program. Well, at the moment that it became a federal program, it expanded much more quickly. There are now 273 programs in 46 states in the United States that
right.
are funded with a federal appropriation. There's another whole growth that's happening internationally, which we can talk about later. But that growth in this country has been tiny compared to the demand and the capacity. So over 1,600 different organizations have applied for those federal funds to bring this opportunity to their neighborhood. At least half of them would be capable and qualified to do a good job at it. The funding should meet that demand and that capacity until we've engaged every young person who's out of school and out of work. Right now there's 6.7 million young people in the U.S. between 16 and 24 who are not in school, not employed. So, you know, we have the resources, we have the capacity, we have the knowledge. We could engage all of the young adults in our society to become productive adults. Instead, we're sending extraordinary numbers to prison for nonviolent crimes, which they wouldn't be committing if they had a job, or if somebody in the school system had supported them adequately with enough respect for their intelligence and their potential to help them navigate their way through poverty to college.
In terms of the organization's evolution in the last few years, describe where you are and also where you would like to be in the next few years.
We've built a wonderful national and now international network of people committed to community economic development through the development of the talents of young people. And there's extraordinary expansion that could happen because we have a delivery system, we have a program design, we have a national nonprofit support system, we have an appropriation of the federal government. But it's way too small, and in the cuts that took place in 2011, the result was about 50 YouthBuild programs closed for lack of funds. So at the same time, in other countries, the same need to engage the young adults is rising to a higher priority, and so South Africa just chose to take the YouthBuild model and expand it to 50 sites in South Africa. Mexico is expanding to 35, using their national funding to do that. So we've grown more rapidly in the last 3 years internationally at the same time as we've been shrinking nationally, even though the need in the U.S. is one that we could actually meet. We could actually shift the whole situation for low-income young people in this country. We could end poverty in a generation if we would intervene at this moment between 16 and 24 before the young people have had the next generation, before they've had their children and are trying to raise them in poverty, where they can see a way to become the person that they really want to be, which is somebody who's succeeding in, you know, various ways chosen by themselves.
Is there an opportunity to replace the funding that the federal government is increasingly reluctant to provide by looking at state sources? Or is this the kind of thing where the overhead cost of trying to do this on a state-by-state level would just be unbearable?
The state funding should flow into the national delivery system, and there should be state funding that comes both from the public education system and from the criminal justice system, because YouthBuild programs lower recidivism rates by 40 percentage points. You know, every dollar invested in YouthBuild, according to research, produces a return on that investment of at least $7.80 up to $43.90 if these are young people who've been in trouble with the law. And about 30% of our students have been in trouble with the law. So the states could save a lot of money by investing in YouthBuild. What we have lacked to be able to achieve that is sufficient funding for the advocacy that it takes. I mean, you have to have at least one full-time person in any state which you're going to try and persuade to move money from the criminal justice system to this, you know, reentry program. You can't just, it just doesn't happen by itself. The difficulty of getting the philanthropic world and individual supporters to support the advocacy that you have to do to get the public policy that you need in order to invest in the opportunities for low-income young people is the starting point for how you need to do this change. Very few politicians are committed to eliminating poverty in this country. The poor people aren't voting at the same level, and it's not a popular term even. You barely can get elected officials to use the word poverty. Right. But it is expanding, and inequality is expanding. Extreme inequality is increasing in a way which, partly because of the social media and the technology, more and more people are aware of how unfair the system is shaping up to be. Now, We have accessed some public education funds. Mm-hmm. We've created about 100 diploma granting schools, which are funded either as charter schools or as certified alternative schools. That helps, right? But then what you have is you have half the program. You have a good school where the teachers care about the students and they belong to a good community, but then you don't have the funding to actually build the tangible assets in the community that give the young people so much pride and where they learn the hands-on skills.
The workforce development skills, not workforce development in terms of some external program, but from inside.
So there is a miracle of transformation of young people's identity, of how they view themselves. If they have a chance to learn and to produce something of value to their community that other people are respecting and saying, wow, you know, thank you for doing that, then they say, as one young man, Antoine Bennett, said to a congressman one day, he said, I used to be a menace to my community, now I'm a minister to it. I used to be an ex-con, now I'm an icon. I used to be a hoodlum, now I'm a hero, because I got a chance to build housing in my community while I earned my high school diploma. Everyone was proud of me.
So it's prominence, but a prominence in such a positive way. And it gives this sense of power, and that power can become infectious. And wouldn't it be great if that person infects the next person, infects the next person, infects the next person?
Well, and they do. And I've taken to asking groups of YouthBuild students, how many people have you already helped in your life? The first time I asked this group, sitting around 14 young people, and I said, pick a number and then defend the number. So they did. And when we were done, these 14 young people counted 2,432 people that they had already helped. Now, a lot of our YouthBuild students are YouthBuild AmeriCorps members, so we've merged with the National Service Movement.
Right.
AmeriCorps is also authorized in public law, and what that allows the YouthBuild students to do is to earn a college scholarship, an education award through AmeriCorps for the service they do building affordable housing. And that's another, and so that kind of collaboration between YouthBuild and AmeriCorps is another way to build capacity of the young people.
A phenomenal model, a transformational idea coming from the youth and from communities itself. It is just such a pleasure to learn from you, Dorothy, and thank you so much for sharing your experience, and thank you for your insights.
Thank you.